Hello there. Now, today, we're going to talk about big data. It's a big buzzword that has been coming around, involving all of us, and in this case, big data in marketing. So I'm going to talk about developments in big data. Data is boring, normally, especially when you're talking about, my God, you know, the evolution of data since, let's say, the last 9-10 years, where we had, you know, a number of zettabytes, and nowadays, so from terabytes, you know, 10 raised to the power of 12 zeros to zettabytes, raised to the power of 21, and we are heading towards yottabytes, 10 raised to the power of 24. Yeah, it's incredible, but what is important is really to analyze the movement of data, the patterns of data, through machine learning, through a number of algorithm compressibility tools, but very important is to analyze what lies behind the data. So yes, normally we talk about big data, but in fact there is a classification and difference between big data, thick data, and wide data. And it's important just to remember, if you're talking about, self-reporting data, interviews, consumers, industry interviews, etc., that is what we call thick data. If you're talking about big data, that is really completely different, because you're talking about social sentiment analysis, we're talking about trends, search trends, about census data. And if you're talking about wide data, that is more competitor analysis, industry trends, so PESTEL, SWOT analysis, that are a bit obsolete nowadays, but any type of diagnostic data, that is called wide data. Very, very important to analyze the meaning and to extract the meaning and to bring to the surface. That's why nowadays, for instance, data warehouses are a bit on the way out, and now there is the rise of what you call metadata catalogs. That is incredible, because what we want to achieve is to explore, to discover the meaning of that data. And we can use tags. Tags to understand the relationships between these data assets and to provide information, relevant information, and minimize the time that you are doing for searching this. So the rise of metadata catalogs to help people find worthy data, analyze worthy data. So discovery process, understanding process, very, very important. And of course, we use artificial intelligence, machine learning. In fact, big data and data are the raw material, the raw element to feed machine learning, and then further down, deep learning. So clearly, a number of searchable user interfaces, and this can actually reduce the time, also increase the trust on the data, accurately query the data. So metadata and these metadata catalogs is really a way forward. We've got more data speed, we've got more storage capacity, we've got certainly more processing power in terms of computation, we've got more production tools, social network usage, more online commerce, digital management, digital marketing, more mobile usage as well. And of course, don't remember that the Business Institute from the IBM, Business Value Institute, they define that, you know, and everybody knows that, you know, 90% of the data that we have nowadays was acquired in the last 2 years. And that is incredible, 2 years alone. But more and more nowadays we are talking about, especially in Sweden, Martin Lindström came up with the concept of little data, small data. Because sometimes we've got this huge, massive amount of dark data that companies collect all this data, but only about 20% are actually analyzed, 80% of dark data. And we're talking about what lies behind the data, the meaning, the people, the human beings, and then therefore the concept of little data and small data. So why big data with this small data needs also a paradigm shift. If bigger is better when it comes to data, maybe small data can also actually throw some light. And in fact, there are a number. In terms of marketing, what we call the intention economy, consumers, how they make choices, intentions, how they develop intentions, that comes from small data, not big data. So small data, this actually approaches, Martin Lindström approach is very interesting, you know, concept, because we need to spend time in the context, in the real environment where people are, in this case, consumers. And through the observation, this actually can provide very powerful marketing insights. It's clearly a human-centric approach to big data. based on observation of small samples, small groups, etc. The importance of being there, you know, walk with me, being present, clearly. And also, small data actually brings some kind of humanity into marketing. So, clearly, to countervalue this incredible big data, I mean, just to give you an idea, we're talking about sensor technology. Nowadays, there are about 150 million sensors in the world. We're talking about 40 million data points per second. I mean, it's incredible. This is actually astonishing, the amount of big data. So it's really a data deluge. But there are a number of misconceptions. For instance, oh, more data equals much better decision-making process. Not necessarily. Definitely not. The data, yes, eliminates uncertainty. Really? Are you sure that more data can actually help you to cope with uncertainty? Look at what we are living now, you know, for the last 5 months with this pandemic and COVID-19. The belief that uncertainty can ever be eliminated or reduced, you know, this can lead to data. This can lead to unexpected expectations, can lead to frustration, and even can lead with paralysis of engagement, of decision making, of implementation. Clearly. What about data related to the consumer? This is clearly the era of data consumer. Consumers have more and more, we can use consumers if with their permission. A DIY user research. We can actually collect data through them. Ethnographic mobile ethnography, for instance, or using sensors in their clothes, if they allowed. And we can have this crowdsource of bringing more and more information. This is what we call passive data collection. And this is a big, probably will become a very important primary technique for data collection, which can analyze changes in consumer behavior, etc. We talk about big data, but the experience, a huge explosion in data volume, is something that is around us. Smart, connected consumers, connected individuals. So, you know, data that can be emitted from clothes, sensors, wearable tech, gadgets worn by consumers can actually be a very important element to generate data. Every day, their own life, but of course with their permission. This is very important, privacy, to defend privacy rights. And in fact, more and more consumers are standing up and actually the concept of data mining, not data mining in terms of algorithm compressibility, but data MY, my data. You can only use my data if you are actually providing better services, accurate, value for me, otherwise I will not allow you to use my data, or you pay me. And you see a number of companies, even in terms of utilities, in Scotland, where I live, where consumers are standing up and saying, well, you know, if you want to use my data, you have to pay me about £250 a year. So data mining, interesting. But also, of course, big data has allowed us to exploit a number of issues about dealing with consumer and customer information. Well beyond relational databases, we are talking now about knowledge graphs. Knowledge graphs of customer profiles, of consumer profiles. And these knowledge graphs can model very complex relationships between the individual and customers and a number of relevant entities around the customer. Friends, family, products, sentiment about brands, brand sentiment, purchasing power, etc. And all that is done through, obviously, machine learning. Machine learning, very, very important, artificial intelligence. So we have data computation, we have network, and we have interfaces. And this is very, very crucial. And also the impact of this technology, again, on privacy. I am very, very concerned about the ethics and about these infringements of privacy. So either if you are using IoT, Internet of Things, if you're using augmented reality, or biometrics, or cloud computing, or big data analysis, you have to bear in mind the issue of privacy and not encroaching into people's lives without their permission. But yes, I mean, the IoT, this year, 2020, we are expecting between, I mean, it's a wide range between 40 billion and 80 billion objects that are connected amongst themselves. I don't go for the lower part of this estimation. I will go for about certainly over 50 billion objects connected, about 10 devices per individual. Each person will have about 10 devices connected with their devices. So every man, woman and child on the planet, they will have at least 10 connected objects. That is, and of course, they function and they actually are seen as human sensors. And this is part of the Internet of Things, observing data to the IoT, etc. Not only in terms of consuming data, how they consume, but everything that is part of their lives. I was conference chairman and also keynote speaker at the conference in Prague, Czech Republic, last year, 2019. And I made acquaintance with a very, very important scholar from Poland, from Poznan University of Economics and Business, Wojciech Celery, has done a lot of studies about that. I mean, the implications of technology, Internet of Things, into the privacy of human beings. And for instance, in terms of IoT, his studies tell me that 70% of the devices, the 10 devices per person, show 70% vulnerabilities with regard to privacy. IoT device vulnerabilities. So we need, and consumers are becoming more, and citizens are becoming more and more data conscious. The need for consumers to, and citizens to understand data, how it is used, and this will grow in the future. Education will be needed to combat inequalities and enable people to fully take part in society, understand this data. And this will become a very important element, a very important part of the civic self-consciousness. Of course, in my talk on biometrics, I spoke about body data. So big data being transformed into body data, that will be very important in the future. Through clothing, through sensor technology, you can have your heart transmitting information, you can have your jacket with wearable sensors, single points of data. You can have, you know, everything, you know, I can actually have the type of face, the type of hair that you have, the type of clothing, the type of body, long hair, short hair, color of the hair, biometrics, the unique characteristics of the individuals. And this is incredible, it's really body data. And then if you can actually superimpose, have an overlay of a different level, what we call knowledge and context, you will find out that the actual devices become more useful because you can have, oh yes, location. Yes, this person likes to go to the cinema, he likes to type on the theater, this type of genre, he likes action, he likes films like that. Normally he goes with a friend Jenny, he goes in the afternoon, he doesn't like to go in the evening. Normally he spends between 12 and 80 pounds on the ticket, the times, all this incredible information that can actually come through an app to define information about knowledge and context through biometrics. And with the permission, no infringement of privacy, the permission of human beings and consumers. Through all these wearable senses, these unique characteristics that are emitting information through your wearable technology. But context is very important, not just knowledge context. And for me, there are six pillars, six building blocks that define this context in terms of big data. One is obviously the wearable computing. We are using wearable computing. Big data per se, data computation, all the analytics and the type of things that we do from machine learning and all the neural network topologies, recurrent neural networks, you know, convolutional neural networks if you're dealing with images, very important. And of course, sensor data coming from sensor technology, social network data, how you relate nexus points with people, who's going to be the influencer, and of course, location, location data, location casting through sensors, beacons, etc., etc., that will give me all this information. So we are moving, maybe, you know, in 10 years from now, not just big data, we'll be talking about the next level of data, humongous level of data, humongous data. We're talking about nowadays, I mean, can you imagine, 600 terabytes, a terabyte, 10 raised to the power of 12 zeros of data transmission per month. Huge data deluge. And there are more and more advances. I'm not going to bother you talking about that. I'm just going to give you one. For instance, we are moving towards what we call Li-Fi. Li-Fi? Yes, Li-Fi is the transmission of data through illumination. Sending data through a light-emitting dioxide light bulb that varies the intensity faster than any human eye can follow. Incredible. I hope you enjoy. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.